I'm smiling and laughing with you as a good three or four of you had a fantastic stab of singing We Three Kings to Angels We Have Heard on High, I think is the hymn I picked. If you're joining us through the wonders of digital mediums, welcome to the service of St. Helens and St. Richard's here for my first service here at St. Richard's. It's lovely to have you with us digitally. But of course, it's a pleasure to be with each of you in person. Christmas, in one sense, has passed quickly this year. For me, it's gone with a little bit of a blur, celebrating the Nativity at the same time as getting to know you and wondering what boxes are the things I've packed in. Good morning. I think I stuck a minute off you. Come on in. But of course, Christmas this year passes quickly liturgically as well, because Epiphany is what they call a movable feast. And so today, as we meet on the 2nd, I think it's the earliest that we'll ever have Epiphany. So of course we will have the quintessential Epiphany carol, We Three Kings. But as we're working music out, the reason that they didn't match was because the hymn that we have digitally, we didn't have in the hymn books here. So I think we were a shoo-in had we been at St. Helens. But of course, had you been singing at St. Helens, I would have been celebrating on my own. So please, friends, bear with me as I work out how the hymn books work and how our music works. As I think I said in the previous service, our worship is the glory of God. I wanted to have it as good as possible. But in the economy of things, teething does not matter, because we worship with our hearts. With that being said, let us begin to prepare our hearts as we meet in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. The Lord will be your everlasting light, and your God will be your glory. So let us prepare ourselves to meet with him in word and in sacrament as we pray together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets hide, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The grace of God has dawned upon the world through our Saviour Jesus Christ, who sacrificed himself for us to purify a people as his own. So therefore, with confidence and humility, let us confess our sins as we pray together. Almighty God,
our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate thoughts. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Friends, let us stand as we worship and say together, glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, And so we pray and collect for this, the Feast of Epiphany. O God, who by the leading of a star manifested your only Son to the peoples of the earth, mercifully grant that we who know you now by faith may at last behold your glory face to face through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us be seated to hear from God's holy word.
The first reading is from Isaiah chapter 60, verses 1 to 6. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you. See, darkness covers the earth, and thick darkness is over the peoples. But the Lord rises upon you, and his glory appears over you. Nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look about you. All assemble and come to you. Your sons come from afar, and your daughters are carried on the hip. Then you will look and be radiant. Your heart will throb and swell with joy. The wealth on the seas will be brought to you. To you the riches of the nations will come. Herds of camels will cover your land. Young camels from Midian and Ephah, and all from Sheba will come, bearing gold and incense, and proclaiming the praise of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm is Psalm 72, verses 10 to 15. May the kings of Tarshish and of distant shores bring tribute to him. May the kings of Sheba and Seba present him gifts. May all kings bow down to him, and all nations serve him. For he will deliver the needy who cry out, the afflicted who have no one to help. He will take pity on the weak and the needy, and save the needy from death. He will rescue them from oppression and violence, for precious is their blood in his sight. Long may he live, may gold from Sheba be given him. May people ever pray for him and bless him all day long. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter 3, verses 1 to 12. For this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles, surely you have heard about the administration of God's grace that was given to me for you. That is, the mystery made known to me by revelation, as I have already written briefly. In reading this, then, you'll be able to understand my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to people in other generations, as it has now been revealed by the Spirit to God's holy apostles and prophets. This mystery is that through the gospel the Gentiles are heirs together with Israel, members together of one body, and sharers together in the promise in Christ Jesus. I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace, given me through the working of his power. Although I am less than the least of all the Lord's people, this grace was given me to preach to the Gentiles the boundless riches of Christ, and to make plain to everyone the administration of this mystery, which for ages past was kept hidden in God, who created all things. His intent was that now, through the Church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms, according to his eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ Jesus, our Lord. In him, and through faith in him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. This is the word of the Lord.
Your benefit that I keep it. We have seen his star as his rising, and have come to pay him homage. Hallelujah. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
The reading comes from the second chapter of Matthew, verses 1 to 12. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod, the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose, and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet, 'And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child. And when you found him, bring me word, that I too may come and worship him." After listening to the king, they went on their way. And behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. Then, opening their treasures, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. If you'd like to be seated. Heavenly Father, we pray that the words of my mouth will be honouring to you and may be helpful for those who gather. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. How many of you here read novels in your spare time? Quite a few. Yeah, there we go. Okay, so out of those that you read novels, how many of you read it in the order that the words are on the page? Start with, yeah? Okay, yeah. That's why we're in. The vast majority of you looked at me and went, "No." What do you mean? Well, the question is this. When a book is published, we start with chapter 1. Chapter 2 is then printed, 3, 4, 5, until however many chapters are over. Now, I thought that was the way that everybody read a book. Start with chapter 1 and go to the end. I got to about the age of 14 or 15 until my mother casually said to me, "Oh, I always read the last chapter first." Okay, so some of you are shaking your heads, so it's sacrilege, not a chance. Some of you are chuckling. Does anybody want to fess up that they do that? At least one person. Yeah. Oh yes, okay, you do. Sometimes.
I started on chapter 24.
start at 25. Some people do it not by accident, but on purpose.
I did it by accident.
You did it by accident. Well, do you know what? Actually, there is a way of reading the Bible that people do by accident as well. You see, it's very easy when we read the Old Testament, the prophets and the prophecies now, and presume that we live at the end of the story. And so when we read chapters like chapter 60 that we heard that excerpt from this morning, we presume that this is a chapter that's already happened because we're reading it now. But actually, it's a chapter that pictures the end of where we're moving to and going to. One of the things that God did in his loving kindness was he allowed us to read the way the story finishes before we reach it. And the reason for that is to give us hope, confidence, security, and peace. But the challenge then is, if in our writings and the prophecies of Jesus, we read it casually or accidentally, or even worse, we read it quickly or out of context, we can leave ourselves confused. Because as we heard read from Isaiah, herds of camels will cover your land, young camels of Midian and Ephah. And we know that the light has come. I hope that the one thing you can be confident of after the past few weeks is that Christmas has occurred, the Christ has come, the light has dawned. And if the light has dawned, surely the camels should be covering Israel. Surely it should be that the kings of Tarshish should be coming, as we heard in the psalm. Actually, in chapter 60 of Isaiah, and in the Psalm 72, we're seeing a picture of the conclusion of the world. It's what theologians call the eschatological vision, which you and I know as reading the last chapter before it's occurred. And the reason that it's important that we can work out whether we're reading stuff that has happened, or is happening, or will happen, is because we can slip into tradition and fiction and fantasy. And then when we look at the world around us, we go, why is the world like this? If the light has dawned, why is it that some of this stuff isn't occurring? And the answer is that even though the light has dawned, history still unfolds. We still are in verse 2 where darkness covers the earth. But the difference between before Jesus coming as a child and living his life, and the difference before that and now, is that the light has dawned, the light has shone. Now I hope that immediately as I'm talking about this, this doesn't feel academic to you. It doesn't feel above your heads. Because I hope that in it you can see that the reason that we're careful is because we're invited into God's story. And we're invited in because he wants to be with us. He values us. He doesn't see us as an accessory or a statistic, but sees us as a person. So how then are we to respond to Isaiah's prediction? Well, firstly, we take heart. Because every time God prophesies something, he gives us a prophetic sign. He gives us a foretaste. For those of you that like your fine dining, there is an amuse-bouche at the beginning of the prophecy. What happens when the shepherds see the angels? What are they told to do? Go and see the child. And the sign will be he will be there in swaddling bands. They go, they see, they are excited. And so with the prophecy of Isaiah, on Epiphany, we celebrate the fact that the beginnings of Isaiah have already begun to become true. The reason that we celebrate the Magi coming to the birth, or rather to the side of the child Jesus, is because that was about to be quite atmospheric music, wasn't it? Building to the point. Is because actually God is building a crescendo through history. And the wise men, as they bring gold and frankincense and myrrh, begin to prove and demonstrate the first fruits. God is active in history. And what's more is, how many of you have been or want to pilgrimage to Jerusalem? A few of you. I was able to go a few years ago on a clergy pilgrimage taster. As far as I know, I don't have a drop of Jewish blood in me. I am 100% Gentile. I am a good Lancashire mutt. And yet, I wanted to go to Jerusalem because the light has dawned. But what does that mean for us here in this moment? Well, when we understand where we sit, we can begin to see the theme and the point of some of these prophecies. We can begin to apply them to our lives. In verse 4, the Holy Spirit, speaking through Isaiah, says to Zion on the day of healing, lift up your eyes and look about you. See what's going on and look. Your heart will throb and swell with joy. Friends, like the shepherds, like the wise men, like the people on the day of the final healing, we can look around us, we can look up, and we can choose to see what we see. You see, friends, you can turn the news on, and whether you it doesn't really matter what news you read, whether you are Guardian, Telegraph, Mail, Sun, whether for some weird reason you like the Liverpool Echo down here in Hangleton, whatever you're reading, doesn't matter. You can choose to see that as the final word, or to look around you and see what God's doing in the answers to prayer. You can share when God answers the prayers that you're praying. You can say to your friends, your church family, do you know what? I was praying about this, and you'll never guess what God has done. And you can choose to see that and allow your heart to rejoice. And friends, it's a choice. It really is a choice. And the second thing, however, we can do is we can again begin to become like those rulers that will come and offer gold and frankincense. We can be like the wise men. We can come. And we can do it as a community, and we can do it as individuals. Gold doesn't take particular insight to know what gold's about. Gold is about the financial wealth that we have. And some of us may be absolutely dripping with money. Some of you may not know what to do with it because you are so rich that you think, I can't spend it fast enough. Some of you right now are hoping you will do that. Others of you might have to count every penny because you need to know precisely where each penny goes. But either way, you know what gold is. And actually, you know what frankincense is as well, probably. Frankincense was used in the worship of the ancient world. Some churches still use it weekly today. And when the wise men, when the rulers of the nations bring gold and frankincense, they are paying homage to Jesus with the money that they have and the heart and the worship that they have. And as I come into land, I just want to share with you a perspective of that, both as a church and as people, individuals. What does it look like for us as a church to live now? Not in the future, not in the final chapter. Well, it is to listen to Jesus' great commission. Go into the world and make disciples of all nations. And if we are going to be like the wise men and steward our wealth as a church, that means being realistic with the money that we have, the buildings that we have, ordering our community such that we are a light to Hangleton, and we are an invitation so that people can come and see, know, taste, and experience what we have, that Jesus is alive. He loves us. He's died for us. He reigns over us. And so we're going to go on a journey looking to see how we can use our resources. And the worship that we bring needs to be in spirit and truth, because the reality is that you can have a thumping good hymn, but if it is not likes the truth of life, doesn't even begin to key into things, the spirit leaves. God will not be mocked. We worship in spirit and truth. And so then, if our worship is going to be accessible and understandable, and it's going to bring glory to God, what does that mean for us as individuals? Well, we ourselves have to be disciples. Friends, I am first and foremost a man who has been saved by Jesus. I'm a man who has become a disciple. And because I got ordained, I didn't cease being a disciple. I didn't stop following Jesus to turn and say, hey folks, come follow me. Rather, as Paul said in his letters, come follow me as I follow Christ. We are disciples together. And so when it comes to our finances, whether you've got a little or whether you've got a lot, the question is prayerfully, am I thankful? Am I going to take seriously the fact that whatever I have is a blessing from God, and so I will give back to God for the ministry and mission of his church? And when it comes to our worship, is Sunday morning all we do? Do we turn up, clock in, clock out? Or do you pray the rhythm of your week? One of the things that I hope to do over Lent is to run a Lent course. And my hope is that Lent course will actually grow into a small group where people have the opportunity to gather together so that we can be disciples together. And all of this is because we live in that beautifully complex middle. We're not in the final chapter. We're going through the story. And there is complexity, and there is hardship, and there is confusion at times. But the light has dawned. Though there may be darkness around us, we know the light. Let us orientate ourselves to the light so that we are not ensnared by darkness. And so every time we gather together to partake of Christ's presence with us in the Holy Sacraments, we stand together as the church to proclaim the truth that witnesses to the light. So let us stand together and let us proclaim the church's faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified on Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will come in. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Friends, in confidence, let us present our prayers and our supplications to the throne of grace, if you'd like to sit on the earth. first and foremost pray for Hamilton, for our community. We pray in the name of Jesus that by your Spirit you would be at work drawing people to yourself. That just as the Magi ended up at the feet of Jesus in ways unexpected, so too in this place, in St. Helens and St. Richard's, we would come to know of people meeting you in unexpected ways. Father, we pray that we would see the joy of people coming to faith, not for our benefit, but for theirs and for yours. Father, we pray that our friends and our loved ones would have an experience of you. Draw them by your Spirit, that they may hear the word and believe. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we pray for ourselves. Father, as we pray week in, week out, the confession, and we walk the path of repentance, Lord, we pray that you would pour out your Spirit upon us. We pray that we would grow in faith. We pray that we would grow in love. We pray that we would grow in understanding. That you would be glorified in our lives, both as a church and as individuals. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray for those on our parish prayer list. We pray for Jack, for Chloe, for Christine, Sue and Peter, Ian, Jill, David, Ross and Howard, Alan, David, Carrie and Alan, Ian and Ken and Karen. Father, you know their needs, their hurts, their wants and their desires. We pray that you minister peace and healing to them in Jesus' name. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
And finally we pray, Lord, as we as a nation commence 2022, Father, we pray that you would guide our politicians. We pray that you would guide Her Majesty's government and Her Majesty's loyal opposition to policies that reflect your concerns for the world. We pray for our local MP, our local council. Lord, we pray that they will be attentive to your will. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our Saviour Christ is the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there shall be no end. And so may the peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us offer one another an appropriate sign of Christ's peace. We are now going to have hymn number 788. It is a Victorian, isn't it? A Victorian favourite, We Three Kings. It has one of the unenviable qualities of hymns to, in the first line, manage to get two things wrong in almost as many words. We've just heard the reading from Matthew. There was most certainly not any kings, there were wise men. And as for the number, we guessed off the gifts. The reality is the wise men will come as an entourage. And so as we sing We Three Kings, we sing looking to the day when the prophetic sign is fulfilled, when all the kings bow at the feet of Jesus. We sing We Three Kings of Orient are.
Thank you.
Lord, accept your people's gifts, not gold, frankincense, or myrrh, but hearts and voices raised in praise of Jesus Christ, our light and our salvation. Amen. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh as your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin. He lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us, and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. And now we give you thanks and praise for the leading of a star. You have revealed your only Son to the world, that in following him, we are led from darkness into marvelous light. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna.
Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom. And with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. And as we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send your Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of St. Richard and St. Helen and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we will share in one bread.
Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace.
Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
So draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him with your hearts, in your hearts, I should say, by faith, with thanksgiving. Amen.
Amen.
Friends, in a moment, you're going to be invited to come. As you know, this is both joyful for me, because it's the first time we get to celebrate here in this building together, but it does mean I'm still slightly working out how to do, if you like, the choreography of our dining and celebrating together. And so, in my mind's eye, this is what's going to happen. I'm going to stand on the bottom step, and if you would come single file to me, and just as we've done at St. Helens, there is an opportunity to receive him in both kinds. But if you're nervous and concerned because of COVID and you want to receive in a single kind, just put that finger up towards me. Let me know in some way. And if you want to come forward for a blessing, because this is the table of blessing for those who have confessed faith in Christ and him in the Trinity. If you're on that journey of faith, please come forward. I'd love to pray a blessing over you, because this is the table of blessing, whether you receive of him in the sacrament or receive from him in prayer. With that being said, can I ask you, please don't kneel as you receive communion. I found out that it was quite difficult at St. Helens when people kneeled. Now, I know for some of you that is important and it's precious to you to kneel as you receive Christ. Can I just say I'm with you on that? Actually, for me, in my own heart, I would love to be kneeling. But actually, in this moment, at least while we're still navigating these things, I'd ask you not to, because I get quite nervous that I'm going to tip him down you or accidentally drop him. And the embarrassment would be ours to share and let us worship him without concern. So with that incredibly long preamble, friends, draw near with faith.
Thank you.
so having received from Christ in the hearing of his words and receiving him into our bodies through this sacrament, we pray together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Before we have the blessing and the dismissal, I just don't know if you take communion. Some of you may wonder why I'm leaving the white piece of linen and the card on the top of the chalice. That might look unusual to you. The reason is because of COVID. It's because I'm going to be intincting and giving you. And as I'm praying you Christian prayer, whilst I don't have COVID, God willing, I hope none of you have given it to me since I arrived. there is just that sense of wanting to be precautious. So if you're wondering why I'm excited, if that's what that's there for. Next week we are together once more at St. Helen's. As far as I'm aware, there are no notices to be given for the coming weeks. So that's right, am I right, Wardens? Yeah, correct. This coming week I'm going to be hopefully getting all the dates for our PCCs lined up for the year. So keep an eye out for your email, probably towards the end of the week. It might be at the beginning of next week, depending on a few meetings that I need to get in line to sort that out. But so for those of you who are on the PCC and have been missing those lovely hours together, fret thee not, the diaries are to be populated. But of course, that is the least of the joys in the Christian life. So let us stand for the blessing that we may receive from Christ. May God the Father, who led the wise men by the shining of a star to find the Christ, the light from light, lead you also in your pilgrimage to find the Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Our recessional hymn is Be Thou My Vision. We of course see by light, and light helps us to see in all things. We who have orientated ourselves to Jesus want him to be that vision. So let us sing together, Be Thou My Vision.
Thank you.
So as we commence into 2022, may Christ be your vision as you go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.
Amen.